Good morning. The small topic which is related to the dredging techniques. So in dredging, we had seen a lot of techniques of different categories such as the mechanical dredging, hydraulic dredging, and the hybrid dredging. So in continuation to that, or in that dredging itself, a small topic which we would like to cover, that is barges. Now barge is nothing you have seen in a lot of dredging types, that there is a large open platform which is floating on a floating in water. So that large open platform, it is nothing but technical name to that open platform is a barge. Okay. So just definition wise, if you see, so it's a large vessel which is the main purpose of that vessel or that floating platform, it is to carry the cargo. Or cargo is also a technical term. So instead of cargo, any type of load it can carry. So generally you see large containers which are stacked in a railway yard near the yards, stocking yard. So those are nothing but cargo containers in which different types of material can be shipped from one place to another, and that one place to another, it can be as long as, or the distance can be between two continents or two countries which are separated by water. So there barges come into picture, and the only disadvantage you can say of a barge is it is not a self-driven vehicle kind of thing. As we have ships and boats which float on water, as well as they have an engine and they have all the controls so that it can move in water. So barges are not that kind of structure. Barges are only large open platforms which are floating on water. So there is no independent engine or any kind of equipment which will help that barge move in water. So it only floats. So if you have to move that barge in water, so you have to use a different boat or a different ship which is towed, or it is only just stuck to the barge, and then it pulls the barge in the desired direction. So that's the only disadvantage that you can say a barge can have. But that disadvantage, or the reason for this, is that a barge doesn't has an engine or a control unit, is because the intention of using the barge is the maximum space should be utilized for cargo transport or transporting of the material. So as much as space is made available, it is beneficial to the cargo handler, because then they can make, or they can handle a large amount of cargo in just one trip itself. Okay. So that's why they don't have a moving or self-driving facility. You have to use independent boats or vessels to move them. Okay. And the flat is, or bottom is just a flat shape like a raft. Okay. And as I told you, the main reason for this shape is that cargo carrying capacity has to be enhanced. Okay. So that's why they are open just as a raft kind of thing. Now, being said that this is a barge, so there are different types in that too. So here you see it's an equipment or a material barge. So you see it's a long barges. You can see here there are four barges, four vertical stripes kind of thing, and they are connected together, and all the four are then towed to this boat over here. Okay. And that boat has a that much power to just pull all these four barges. So this is what I was saying, that barge doesn't has its own engine or a driving mechanism, but you have to tow it by some floating vessel. Okay, so this is a normal scenario when you use barges for transporting this cargo container. And not only cargo containers, but if you have some huge amount of material, as you can see in this, it's a ore, okay, iron ore or any metal ore kind of thing, which has been excavated from some mine area, and then it has to be taken to the factories where it will be processed into different kind of metals. So in that case also, if you have a good inland system, so you can use barges for that. That reduces the cost of road transportation, because If you transport this by road or railways, it can take a lot of time, whereas the handling also it is difficult because you have to dump it into the dumpers or the trucks, or in case of railway, you have to dump it into the railway containers, and then you have to load the containers onto the skeleton of that cargo train, and then that train will move. So instead of that, if you have a good inland water system, so you can use barges in there. So again, you can see here, it's a large floating vessel. You have a container or a section in that in which this material is stored. And again, you can see a ship at the end, this side, the front side, which is pulling this barge. It is pulling, or it can pull, or actually it can push also. It's both ways. So here it's pushing. So this is the material of the equipment barge. Then you have a lifting assembly barge. Now it is again a floating structure. You can see at the bottom, but the only difference is now we are not loading it with any kind of cargo material or containers or any heap of material, but instead of that we have assembled a crane structure over here. Okay. It's a sort of a mini tower crane, you can say. So this lifting arrangement is done, and then now again you see this barge has been driven into the water by this small boats over here. So this is, or these type of barges, they are used lifting assembly, obviously to lift something. So we have seen in dredging that you have different types of dredging. You have a grab dredging or a clamshell dredging, ladder dredging, or suction head dredging. So in suction head, not suction head, in cutter head dredging, we had seen that you had to move the cutter head either in left or right direction. So if I just go back to cutter head dredging. So in this, we had seen that this was the cutter head dredging, and you have to move the cutter head right or left to cover a particular area. And then this is done by this wire winches, and these wire winches are attached to this anchors over here, this orange kind of thing. And I had told you there that the anchors, they are moved using a boom or a small work boat. So if there is an arrangement in the dredger itself to move this anchor, so it's well and good. But if not, then you need some equipment to lift it, and then you can use such kind of lifting equipment. Now that anchor is not that heavy that you require such large type of lifting arrangement, but similar kind of thing that you have to lift something from the water body. Okay, just a lifting purpose, you need something. So there you can utilize this lifting assembly barges. Then the another type of barge that we have is a jack-up platform. Now again, this type of figure you have seen in one of the dredging techniques. In one of the dredging technique photo, I guess in excavator dredging, yeah. Here you have seen. So this we were discussing a few lectures back, that it's an excavator dredging or an open dredging, where an excavator is placed on a platform, and then you can dredge the material. And in that, I had shown this photo where you had this black towers. So actually, this whole thing is a barge, and more specifically, it's a jack-up platform type in the barge itself. And on that barge, then this excavator is just placed. So this jack-up, here also you can see the photo. So these are nothing but jack-up platform barge, and the purpose for this is, as I told you, that these can be, or these platforms, they can be lifted. So now it has a particular depth over here, on the right side, if you see the arrow. So it has a particular depth, or that black surface that you see, that is the surface of the bottom surface of the barge. Now if you have to lower it or move it upwards, so then I will use this jack-up platforms to just move this upper platform or elevate it to some extent so that I can get the desired result. Okay, so this is generally used in oil rigs or even in the open kind of dredging that we had seen. So most preferred it is in oil rigs where you have to adjust the heights of the platform or you need a variable height of the platforms. So there jack-up platforms are used. And the foundation, now this is a moving one, but there are permanent, sort of permanent ones also where the platforms are taken in the barges and then it is converted into a permanent structure by just anchoring this pillars in the sea, and then the jack-up platform will hydraulically raise the platform to the desired level. So this is all with the barges. And here we finish one part of our construction technique, that is dredging. So in dredging we saw all the types. We started with what is the type of dredging, what is dredging actually, what are the types, and then we saw different barges. The next construction technique that we will be covering in this course is dewatering techniques. Now dewatering, you all know it's not a new term to anyone. It's quite a general term. Dewatering is nothing but wherever you encounter any water level or groundwater, more appropriately. So if you encounter groundwater during excavation and you have to remove that water, it is not desired to have that water there because you are going to lay some foundation or do some construction over there. So for that, obviously, you need to dewater it or remove that water from its original place. So for that, you need to study the dewatering techniques. And again, for a civil engineer, this is a very common sight that you can see on your right side in the photo. So you start excavating some earth for placing some foundation, and then after a certain depth, you encounter such water, okay, out of nowhere. So if you see in this figure also, for this much depth, there is no water or even the soil is very dry. So you can't really predict that whether there is a water table or not. But then suddenly, after excavating for some depth, you encounter such water tables. So first thing is to avoid such kind of scenario, we do a detailed geological study. So now, what you might have studied in last year in engineering geology. So there are different geological formations, and there are certain geological formations which have such a structure. Either it can be a faulting or it can be connected cracks, due to which if the water is percolated through the surface, so it gets trapped in that kind of structure, and then it remains there until you go on excavating it, and then it shoots up. So if you do that geological investigation very properly, so this kind of scenario doesn't occur. But again, it's an unpredictable thing. You can't really predict 100%, though you do a geological study, that there will not be any water table. Because if you just have to construct a small house, suppose G plus one story, a small house in some area, so you will not go for a detailed geological study because it will be quite expensive. In that case, what we do is we just see the, or we inquire in the locality that which, whatever are the houses which are constructed over there. So we ask them whether during the construction of your house, did you encounter any water table? And then if they say no, then we directly go on excavating. And if they said yes, then we go a bit in depth excavation. So nevertheless, even if we encounter water table, so now we can't just stop the construction, we have to dewater it. So for that, we'll be studying some dewatering techniques in this section. And generally, permanent dewatering techniques are less common. Permanent as in you have all the assembly of that pump and pipes permanently stored, permanently fixed at your site. And then every 24 by 7 for 365 days, it goes on working till the life of the structure. So that kind of dewatering system, it is less common. Mainly, it is very uncommon in India. We'll see some common type of permanent dewatering system in the next few slides. But in India, as far as it is concerned, the permanent solution is, or permanent dewatering system is not common, but temporary ones are there that, okay, you have such kind of excavation, you encounter a water table, and then you just apply some dewatering technique so that you pump out the water. So, and after the water is pumped out, then you resume your excavation and you discard the, or take out the dewatering equipment or setup, whatever was there, and you use it some at some other places. So that is more likely seen scenario in most of the construction sites in India as well as in abroad. So that comes under the temporary dewatering systems. Now the first type in this dewatering system that we will see is a sump pumping. Now what is a sump pumping? It is the most simple type or a basic one. So this is a diagrammatic representation of that sump pumping. So what you have is actually, suppose if I don't consider, or if I make two parts or two sections of this figure, this is first part of that figure and this is second part. So we'll concentrate on the first part for now. Don't assume that there is no second part in this figure. So in this first part, this is the ground level that you have, and suppose you have to construct a huge shopping mall over here. So obviously the area of shopping mall is quite large, so you will not directly go on excavating. You will first do some geological exploration, might be a borehole also, to understand what are the underlying layers, because for a shopping mall, if it is a area wise it is huge, as well as if it is going to be a multi-storied one, so you need to go for some deep foundation as well if the strata is not that hard. So in that case, if you do a borehole excavation and then you encounter, or you come to know that, okay, there is a water table. So now I have to excavate this, or my future plan is that I want to excavate this area so that I can lay my foundations in this area, the area which I have shown in, enclosed in the red dotted line. Okay. So now I know that directly I can't go on excavating because there is a water table and it will just gush out and my excavation will not be that successful. So I need to first lower this water table at least till the depth where till where I want to excavate. Okay. And then below that, if I have to not excavate, so I there is no need of lowering the water table to that much level. So if I suppose this is the depth at which I want to achieve for excavation, so I need to lower this water table, the initial water table level that is shown here. So I have to lower it somewhere here. So my water table, it should be somewhere here. So if it is here, it's no problem to my foundation because it is well above it and it is not going to get flooded during excavation and also during construction. So now what I will do is, instead of directly excavating it and installing a pump here, I'll go a bit on this right side. Now this second part of our picture comes into play. So I'll, before actually excavating there, what I'll do is I'll find a location within my area itself. Now it's a shopping mall complex, proposed shopping mall. So the area is quite huge. So wherever I have to take the foundation a bit away from it, I'll search for a location where I can dig in a hole. A hole or a pit, I can say, more than a hole, a pit. Okay. So I'll dig out a pit, and that pit is known as sump in this case. Okay. So this is that pit I have dig out. So that pit is technically called a sump. So I'll dig out a sump, okay, or a ditch, you can say anything, a ditch or a sump. Okay. A ditch is an open excavation that you do. And sump is moreover that when you excavate, okay, suppose this is the excavated pit, something irregular shape. So in sump, what you do is you put some layers You put some gravel over here. Now the purpose of this gravel is, as we know, we have encountered the water table, and this water table is below the ground level. So obviously, it is not going to be a pure, clean water, okay? Or clear water. There is going to be mud in it. There is going to be soil particles or any kind of particles that you have. So while pumping, if you pump out that particles as well, so it may happen that your pump, after a few minutes or hours of pumping, it might get blocked due to the fine particles which are being pumped along with the water. So in that case, what we do is, instead of directly putting in the pump into the excavated ditch, we create a sump kind of thing like this. Okay, so this is what I have drawn. This is the gravel layer. So that gravel is then placed on all side, and here you have a mesh kind of thing, or any perforated kind of thing which has large perforation. So it can be as simple as a used oil barrel. You just clean it, and then you drill holes on all the sides of the on the periphery of that oil barrel on the surface, and then you just place that oil barrel over here, and you place gravel around it. So now what will happen is, now the well hydraulics or the flow of water will do its work. So we know that water flows in the direction where it has least resistance. So here the water is having some level, but the moment I dig a hole or make a sump over here, a ditch over here, so what will happen is, my water will get a path to flow, and then it will just start flowing from higher level to lower level. Okay. So higher level is this initial water table on the left side, and the lower level now becomes the sump or the ditch that we have excavated. So my water will start flowing in this direction. And once it starts flowing, once your ditch or sump, it gets filled with water. So say this ditch that or sump that we have prepared, it has now filled with water. So what I'll do is, I'll just now use a simple pump, that we use for pumping water into the water tank or outside the water tank. So simple centrifugal pump, you can say, you can install it, and then you can pump out this water. Now here in this line diagram, if you see the sump pump, or simply sump, I'll say, because it's very difficult to say sump pump, it sounds very crazy. So this pump is installed either outside on the ground surface, and you have a pipe through which the water is pumped out, or you can also use a submersible pump. It's a submersible pump nowadays. If you go to the water tanks in your houses, underground water tanks, so most of them have submersible pumps. So you can use that as well. And once you start pumping the water, so the level of this water in the sump, it will go on lowering. And the moment it goes on lowering, this water flow will be simultaneously going on. Okay. So it's like there is an input or there is an inflow of water, and simultaneously you are pumping out the water. Okay. So this can be done, or this process is continued till we get the desired water table. So now here you see a lowered water table is written. So initially the water was somewhere here, and then the level has lowered. And if you see the shape, this shape, if you recall, you have studied something called well hydraulics in your FM. Or might be, if you have not studied, you will study in foundation engineering. But there is something called well hydraulics, in which if you dig a well into a existing water table, so the water table, and you go on pumping out water from that well, so the water table goes on lowering, but it doesn't lower, or the level of the water is never horizontal. It is somewhat like this because there is a well over here. Okay? And then you have water over here in your well. So that's why you see the lowered water table, it is in the slanting or the curve shape, following the conventions or the concepts of well hydraulics. And then this water table is lowered up to the desired level. So we want it to be this water level to be lower till this dotted line. So we'll lower it accordingly. Till then, we'll keep on pumping the water. And once that is achieved, then we'll just switch off the pump and then we can start excavating. Okay. So in this way, your sump pumping, it works. So this is just the theory that I just explained. So it is merely a hole in ground sump, and then water is pumped out of it. Okay. And the sump should be preferably lined with a filter material. So this is what I was talking about. So this is the sump that we had created, and the filter material we used was gravel. So you can use any filter material. It can be a geotextile, or as simple as a heavy plastic having some holes in it. So that can be also used as filter material. That all, this filter material will depend on what kind of soil you have in this surrounding area where you have excavated the ditch. Okay. And as I told you, submersible pumps can also be used. So here you see it's an example of a sump pumping. So this is the ditch that has been excavated. And if you see now, they have not really lined it with anything, because this photo is taken from a mining area. So in mining areas, you really don't need to be that particular about the water which is to be pumped. We just want that muddy water to be taken outside. So even if a small amount of soil comes along with it, we don't have any issue, because we are interested in the soil which we have to excavate, or the ore that we have to excavate from these mines. But this is also an example of a sump pumping, so that you have a ditch here, and then whatever will be the water in the surrounding area, water table, it will flow into this sump or a ditch, and then you can just pump attach a pump over here, centrifugal pump, and then you can just pump out the water. So another very good application of sump pumping that we will see is the basement. Now, basement, you all know, it's a sort of a structure or a room or a part of an existing structure, but just the level is below the ground level. So in basement, whenever you go below ground level, one thing that you often find is a very damp effect, okay, or some bad smell due to this leakage kind of thing. And nobody likes that bad smell, obviously, or nobody likes this leakage in the basement, because that defeats the purpose of having a basement. So basement is generally given either for parking or for some storage or for regular utilization also in many residential areas. So in India also, you'll find a few areas where this basement type of construction in the regular residential houses, it is common. But more than India, you will find this very common in the abroad countries where they have a lot of cold climate. So in that case, they have one room, a basement, which is below ground level, which will be used for storage purpose, but it can also be used during emergencies such as tornadoes and all kind of thing. So that basement has to be obviously leak proof. Now, if you see here, the basement is constructed, you have a wall, but through the walls you have water which is oozing inside, and then it is being collected in this basement. So the purpose is not being served, or you can't use such kind of basements. So the solution for this is also, you can use sump pumping over here, but a bit sophisticated type of sump pumping. So you have again three diagrams or three figures in this slide. So the first figure, if you see, it's a typical drawing which shows how you can use sump pumping to keep your basement waterproof. So suppose this is the basement, the walls you see, masonry walls. And actually what happens in a basement is you have such type of water oozing out, because there is some percolation of water around the bungalow. Okay, we consider for the case of discussion that it's a basement of a bungalow, and then around surrounding the bungalow there is some area. There might be garden, or there might be just a garage or any parking lot. So water is percolating through that surface, and then that water is not getting away to go deeper inside the earth. So that's why it comes out through the basement walls. So what we can do is we can have a network of weeping tile pipe, okay, or drains, which you can see in figure number 3 on the bottom right. So this is a kind of or a type of weeping tile pipe. Now it's called weeping tile pipe because it's a normal pipe. It's a PVC pipe, but it has holes. So the holes are very small. You can't see. So I'm just marking over here. So you have holes in this pipe, okay? Just like a perforation. So you have holes everywhere at regular intervals. And then these pipes are just laid around the foundation area of your basement. Okay? So you can see this they have laid here. And then it is laid in such a network that the water which will be collected through this pipes, because it is obviously perforated, and if you see this, you have a white kind of cloth which is attached to this pipe. That is because to avoid the entry of soil into this pipe, because as I told you, it's a perforated pipe, so it has holes. Now if water is going to percolate inside this or go inside this, so along with water there can be soil particles as well, because we are working underground. So to avoid the blockage of these holes by the soil particles, we have this cloth kind of structure. So this cloth will just hold the soil particles and pass on the water, clear, sort of clear water inside. And then whatever the drain pipes will collect all the water into a sump tank, which is purposefully built below the basement itself. Okay. So it's just like a small water tank, you can say, but it is known as sump tank, because what we are going to do is through the network of this drain pipes, we are going to collect all the water which might come or which might be percolating from the surface, and it might cause damage to our basement. So we will collect all that water in this pump, and then we have, if you see, we have a submersible pump which is placed inside this tank. And once the water level is achieved or the pump is submerged, then you can just switch on the pump, and then you can discharge this water to the nearby municipal drainage system. It can be a storm water drainage or any kind of thing, or even you can use this water for gardening purpose again. Okay. So if your tank is sufficiently large, so during rainy season you can collect all this water, and maybe in the next season or after a few months you can utilize the same water for gardening purpose when you don't have any precipitation. Okay. So now this whole concept, it works on the criteria that water, it moves in the direction in which it gets least resistance. So water, this you always remember, that water always flows in the direction where you have least resistance. So the moment you provide a path to your water, it will start flowing in that direction. So here we are, what we intend is we want our water to flow automatically without any force. We want our water to flow inside this sump tank. So what I need to do is, though I have laid this network of weeping tile, so I should make sure that all the water which is going to percolate below the soil, it goes in towards this weeping tile, and it doesn't go into this brick construction. So you know, brick construction, it is a brick, it is made of clay, so it is good at soaking water. So even if you plaster it, some amount of water it can be soaked, so we have to avoid that. So for that, what we do is, if you see figure number 2, you have a membrane kind of thing. And this membrane, it is a waterproof membrane, so it avoids water to actually stay on the walls. So it will just, the water will slide over this membrane, and at the bottom of this membrane you have this weeping tile. Okay. So this is the same weeping tile. It's a pipe, but its name is weeping tile. So water will come in contact with this weeping tile. It will pass through this perforated holes or perforation, and then from this pipe it will simply go into the sump tank. Okay, so we are just channelizing whatever water might go or seep inside the below the ground level. We are just channeling it to go towards the weeping tide. Okay. So this is the actual photo of that waterproofing technique that you see, or sump pumping. So this is what I was saying. So this is the ground level. Okay. And you see till this membrane of black color membrane, you see it is attached to the walls, constructed wall, to such a height till where I am going to fill the area. Okay, so I am going to fill this area with soil, cover it, because you can't just keep it open. We have to maintain the ground level. So I'll just fill it. So before filling that, I'll place some kind of membrane, and you see these are also the drain pipes or drain tiles. Okay? And the same are laid over here. If you see this horizontal one, these are connected. So this is the membrane, a waterproof one. So even if water percolates inside, so it will not go through this membrane. Okay. It will just slide over, and then it will go to the nearby pipes. And once it goes to a nearby pipes, you can just collect it. Okay. And if you see here now again, on this second figure on the top right, so this is the white pipe that you see here. You can see the holes predominantly, the size is more. So in this case, what they do is they cover this hole with a layer of gravel. So this is the layer of gravel in figure number 3 on the bottom right. So once you lay the drain pipe or the drain tile, you just cover it with gravel. So whatever are the fines, they will be trapped inside these voids of gravel, and only clear water or sufficiently clear water will pass through this drain tiles, so that there is no blockage. Because once you fill this everything with soil and compact it, so after that, if there is a blockage in your drain tile, so the whole purpose of doing this exercise, it will be defeated, and there will be no use of that waterproofing itself. Okay. So this is another application where you can use sump pumping. So it's a very good application, and you need it most of the days. Okay. So that's all for today. We'll stop here. So today we have started with sump pump, started with dewatering techniques, and we have covered this sump pumping. In the next lecture, we'll go on with the single stage well point system. So that's